Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us at the Upper School Town Hall. We have a full evening. We're going to make sure to reserve some time at the end for questions, but I want to start off by asking Rabbi Kassan to open up with a short Torah program.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you to our incredible administrative and our entire Upper School team for getting us to this night tonight. So that we can discuss our peaceful return to our beloved campus. I wanted to just say a couple of words. I actually saw this really beautiful shot. I know that I quote Rabbi Jonathan Sacks a lot, but what's a night without a little thought from Rabbi Jonathan Sacks on this week's Parsha and Parsha Bereshit. Rabbi Sacks talks about two tragic events that we actually see in this week's Parsha, the first one being Adam and Chava actually being exiled from Gan Eden, right? So they eat the forbidden fruit. And Hashem comes and calls out to Adam and says, Ayeka, where are you? Right? And Hashem is actually, obviously, Hashem knows where he is. But what we actually see, according to Rabbi Sacks, is a dismissal of or refusal to actually take personal responsibility. Because Adam actually responds and says, you know, and actually does not take responsibility. He blames Chava. And then when Hashem turns to Chava, Chava blames the serpent. So we see a refusal of personal responsibility. Similarly, in the parsha, we actually see another tragic event with Cain and Hevel. And when Hashem actually comes, so Cain kills Hevel, and Cain's response is, "Am I my brother's keeper?" When he asks him, "Where's your brother?" His response is, "Where am I my brother's keeper?" So the first one being a refusal of personal responsibility. The second one being a refusal of moral responsibility, according to Rabbi Sacks. So tonight is not just about a return to our campus. Tonight is really about us as a community owning our collective responsibility. One of the core values at the Berman Hebrew Academy is achrayut. And within this pshat, a pshat that I heard is that the achrayut comes from the word acher, right? That in order to take responsibility, the root of the word responsibility is acher, meaning I care for somebody else. I care for something or someone outside of myself. And that's the kind of value that we want to teach the Berman Hebrew Academy. And certainly it is representative of us as a community. So as we look at this week's Parsha and the tragic events that unfolded in terms of the refusal of personal and moral responsibility, it brings us to this evening where what we are talking about is not just how we are going to return to our campus, but what we are going to be talking about is a collective communal responsibility, a physical responsibility, a moral responsibility to each other, to ourselves, to everybody else in our community, to the acher. It is a responsibility to the acher in our community, to how we are going to take care of one another and have this peaceful, safe, and healthy return to our campus. So thank you for joining us tonight. I'm going to pass it back to Mrs. Popper.
Thank you so much. I want to just, before I begin the formal presentation where we're going to talk a lot about the details and the specifics, I just want to share with you how excited we are. Ms. Cooper and I spent the day walking around the building and moving around desks and making sure that we are ready to welcome your students back on Monday for some of you and the following Monday for the rest of you. And we are just thrilled to be able to return to campus. We know that some of you will not be returning with us at this point, but the door is always open if you feel that you want to change your mind and return with us to campus. And so we're so excited. And I also want to express tremendous hakarat hatov, tremendous gratitude to our teachers, our faculty, the other administrators, the other principals, Sarah, Ellie, everyone, Shmaria, everyone who goes in, who has done so much to preparing diligently, meticulously, making sure that we're ready to safely welcome everybody back. The teachers who have constantly amazed me by going above and beyond. And I'm just so grateful to everybody. And so I wanted to just start off with that hakarat hatov. Without further ado, let's get started. So some important dates. We're going to start using blue weeks and orange weeks, and those are all noted in the upper school parent and student calendars. If you don't have them, we can reshare them with you. You should be able to access them. But blue weeks mean that the 10th and the 12th grade will be in person, and the 9th and 11th grade will be virtual. And that week starts on Monday, October 19th. And following week is Orange Week, where grades 9 and 11 will be in person, and the 10th and 12th grades will be virtual. And it's basically alternating every other week. It'll be switching, with the exception of the week of Thanksgiving, because there's only 2 days of school. So we gave those students a couple extra days on campus. And the other thing that's important to note that's coming up is the PSATs for 11th grade. If you haven't registered, just a PSA to make sure to do that. In the upper school, the pod structure is going to be a little bit different, in that each grade is designated as an entire pod. And we'll talk a little bit later about what that means in terms of when we might open or close up a pod for health concerned. But what's important to know is that each pod, meaning each grade, has designated blocks of classroom. They have hallways and stairwells that are designated for their use, and they don't overlap during the day. And so while we're welcoming two grades back at a time, for all intents and purposes, we're going to need to keep them quite separate in order to ensure that we limit the exposure as much as possible. The schedule, one of the important things that we did in the upper school was we wanted to create a schedule that would work whether we were in person or virtual. So the idea of the block schedule with A and B days will continue. Mondays and Wednesdays are A days, Tuesdays and Thursdays are B days, and Fridays alternate back and forth. A quick reminder that this week is the first short Friday, and it's also a B day for the middle school and the upper school. So we will continue with the exact same schedules for those students who will be continuing on Zoom, either because it's their week to be at home or because the students have opted into our virtual schedule. You will use the exact same Zoom links you've been using the entire time. So your experience from home will be the same as it has been up until now, with no interruptions or disruptions. One of the changes, however, will be with our student activities. We reached out, the upper school administration reached out to all of the families. You should have received an email, and thank you for those who responded and gave us some feedback or scheduled phone calls. If you haven't and you still want to, we're here and we really want to hear your feedback. But one of the pieces of feedback that we got was that when the students are home, they really need a longer lunch break away from Zoom, and having programming that we all know is so important for our social emotional health, for our collective community, like advisory, like our grade level programming, doing it while we're on Zoom, having that additional program during the day was just exhausting for our students. And so we've actually responded to that feedback, and we're making a change in that student activities will take place only on the weeks when students are in person. So if it's your week to be at home, you will have no required school programming during the day, besides your classes, obviously. Club times are optional. You're welcome to join virtually. Office hours are also optional. And you're welcome to join those virtually, but they won't be mandatory. And instead, we are prioritizing having those take place when we're in person. When we have a longer break during the day, the first part is designated at lunch, and the second part has always been designated as student activities. And we want to take advantage of those when we're able to be together. So when students are in the building, that's when we'll be having advisory. On Tuesdays and on Thursdays, we'll be having a grade level activity. So we'll still be doing those twice a month, but we're going to do it when we're together in the building. Ms. Cooper, do you want to talk for a minute about Tila?
Absolutely. Good evening, everybody. It's so nice to see all of your faces. And I just want to echo Mrs. Popper with our excitement for welcoming your students back into the building and for continuing to educate and engage those of you who will continue to be online. So we're going to start every day and have tefillah, shacharit, and mincha every day. In keeping with our pod structure, those tefillot are going to be separate. Unfortunately, we're not going to have an opportunity like we've had in years past for alternative tefillah or for students to be davening with the lower school or middle school, but we hope to have great minyanim for every grade. So on the weeks when 9 and 11 are in the building, our ninth and 10th grade will be davening in the media center in the weeks when they're in the building. Our 11th and 12th will be in the upper school Beit Midrash. If your child is virtual, either because it is their week to be virtual with the rest of their grade or they're continuing to pursue the virtual option, they can continue with whatever virtual tefillah that they've been doing up until this point, whether that's davening the Yechidut in your home, davening solo at home, or davening with a local minyan. If they have been participating in our Zoom tefillah option, that option is going to change, and they will actually be Zooming into our live tefillah to be able to participate with us. And we'll have that Zoom available and kind of right adjacent to the Shliach Tzibor, so they'll be able to hear and see what's going on. In the morning, we're going to talk about alert media and the arrival process later on in the presentation. We're asking our students to go directly to their tefillah location and not to go upstairs to their lockers first. And that's coming from a place of health and safety, where we want to make sure that we have adequate supervision and making sure that our students are where they need to be. So we're asking that they go directly to their locations. And part of that is, part of the health and safety piece of this is also that we're asking students to bring their own sidurim to school. We unfortunately won't be able to provide sidurim for students in school. So we're asking students to bring their own. In each location, we will be providing a cubby type space for both sidurim and for talit and tefillin. We will be working with students on hopefully making sure that they have that with them every day. And of course, bringing their talit and tefillin home for the weekend. And that process will also repeat for mincha. They will return to the same place. We'll be davening mincha every day, with the exception of Fridays.
Thank you. And just to let you know, we're going to be having meetings with the students after tefillah this Monday and the following Monday to talk through a lot of these things as well. So we'll be having another town hall conversation with them similar to this. I wanted to share with you that as we sent out an email earlier this week, that there are several teachers who will not be able to return to the building for because we are prioritizing their health and safety, and we want to make sure that everyone is able to continue learning and teaching, but also be able to meet their individual needs. And so when a teacher is not able to be in the building, either because they're not returning to the building for the time being, or because they're out for a day, we will have instructional assistants in the room to provide supervision for the teachers. Additionally, students who are not in the building, either because it's your week to be at home, or because you're opting to for our virtual learning, you'll use the same Zoom links, and the students know, the teachers have been informing the students and walking them through some of these processes and protocols. And a question came in that I wanna address right now, which is, if a student is not feeling well for a day and can't come to school, they will be able to join their classes via the OWL and the same Zoom links. And the flip side of that is that if you have opted for virtual learning and you decide that you wanna change your mind, you just need to let us know with 24 hours advance notice, and we will make sure to get you in alert media. We'll make sure to get you in all the systems, so you'll be able to come from virtual learning back into the building if you so desire. Students are each being assigned lockers, so the students will have a space. We've staggered lockers by grade, so there will be a little bit of space between them. But I want to take this moment and just let you know that while there is some space between lockers, there's not 6 feet between individuals. And so what we're going to be doing is, we've staffed the hallways with faculty who will be helping to keep the flow of traffic. Our medical guidelines is that you can be within 6 feet while masked for a short amount of time, and so the passing time is within that time frame. And so we're going to try to keep the flow of traffic moving, but they do have lockers and they're staggered as best we can. Students should bring a charged Chromebook and laptop to school every day. Please, please, please help your students remember to charge them at night. We have purchased a number of external batteries that they could check out from the school office in order to charge their batteries and their laptops midday, because there are not 25 power outlets in a given classroom, and we don't want students tripping over each other's wires. So we want to make sure to have those available, but please remind your students to charge their laptops. And another thing that we all know about now is that we're asking students to bring their own school supplies, because we're not going to be able to share or borrow from the school. And I will be sending out an updated school supply list, which is updated in that we just added the Sidur, but everything else is the same from August. So if you already bought school supplies, just send them in on Monday. And we'll send it out. It's still on our website as well. Lunch. Each grade level is going to be assigned one indoor and one outdoor space to eat lunch. The 9th or 10th grade will be eating in the media center, and they have an outdoor tent designated for them. The 11th and the 12th grade will be eating in the upper school Beit Midrash, and similarly have a tent outside designated for them. We will be delivering school lunches directly to those spaces. So if you sign up for our school lunch, it will get delivered there. They'll pick it up. They'll be able to sit in one of the desks 6 feet apart. They'll be able to take their masks off for those times, and then we'll ask them to put them on when they are finished eating. The big question that came up from so many students is, will seniors be allowed to go off campus? The answer is yes, as long as they follow the Berman guidelines around masks and carpooling. Ideally, they should be driving themselves. If they have permission from their parents to carpool, we ask that they wear their masks and roll their windows down, weather permitting. And on days where we have required programming, specifically Tuesdays with advisory and Thursdays for our grade level program, they will need to return to campus for those activities. Snacks. So when students are in class, they will be permitted to drink water, but they will not be able to have any other beverages, faculty as well. Students will not be permitted to eat during class time. They will be able to take snack breaks during the passing break. So if they arrive at their next class a few minutes early, they can sit down in their seat, they can eat a snack. But once the room is filled with all the students, they need to put their food away and they can eat at the next break or at lunch. There is 15 minutes of passing time between classes. The first couple of minutes will be spent, we're asking students and teachers to make sure to wipe down all of the chairs and desks after they're done using it. Then they'll be able to go to their lockers. The hallways have all been marked with directional signs. So half of the hallway goes this way and the other half goes this way. And if students feel that they need a mask break, they'll be able to go outside to the upper school designated tents, and they'll be able to take their mask off for a few minutes as long as they stay 6 feet away from other people. And I mentioned the last bullet point already, that there will be moments, especially when we walk through the hallways, when we are at our lockers during this passing time, when we will be within 6 feet, and our medical advice is that that's okay, as long as it's not for extended period of time. Community responsibilities. So all of these policies and protocols are designed because we want to make sure that we prioritize the health and safety of our entire Berman community. We don't wear masks just for ourselves, we wear masks for other people. And students who are finding that they need too many reminders, more than three significant reminders of being in the right place or having their mask on or not congregating, we're going to ask them to opt in to using the OWL for remainder of that in-person week. And they will be permitted to return to campus to in-person learning the next time their grade is on campus, as long as we've been able to have a meeting with an administrator, either Ms. Cooper or myself, a parent and the student. I hope that this isn't really an issue. I'm sure that parents, you'll be speaking with your students about making sure that they are following these protocols. They're designed to make sure that everybody feels safe, our teachers, our students, one another, feel safe returning to the building. And it's part of our community responsibility towards each other. And with that, I'm gonna pass the mic over to Rabbi Kassan.
Thank you. Travel policy, I know that many of you have already seen this. If you're traveling to state with a COVID-19 test positivity rate above 10%, then those students and faculty members will not be allowed back on campus until we receive a negative PCR test result or until they quarantine for 14 days from return. And if you're exposed to someone with COVID-19 while traveling, you will need to quarantine regardless of a negative test result. You will not be able to test out of that quarantine. What I do want to say is that this is currently the state guidelines. We are reviewing these guidelines because as we learn more about hotspots and certainly some states are below this, but then there are certain areas within states, certainly some of the from communities within states. So for example, New York might be below 10%, but then there might be places in New York where people go and visit and some of the from areas that might be above that. So we are having conversations with our medical task force about our travel policy and how we can update it in a way that will make sure that we really keep our community safe. So the reason why this travel policy is on here is not because we just want to reiterate what we've already communicated with you, but rather as a reminder to say to you that there is a current travel policy that we hope everybody's following and we trust that everyone's following. But please know that we are continuing as this thing evolves in this with our medical task force, and we will update you with any changes to our current travel policy. Face coverings. We ask that masks be worn by all students and teachers indoors, except during lunch breaks, which we just heard Mrs. Popper talk about. We are going to be asking that masks be worn outside, especially when physical distancing is not possible. We do have spaces that are available for mask breaks outside. So, you know, our upper school administration will speak to the students about that. Gaiters, the things that look like a neck warmer that you can pull up, or masks with external valves are not allowed. These actually have to be the full mask, the full cloth masks that cover your face. So please make sure that your students come to campus with the right masks. I'm just going to reiterate what Mrs. Popper said, which is we really hope we understand that there are students and families that may have different standards or and how they wear the masks or the kinds of masks or when they wear the masks, but it is really important that at school we are all one community and that we buy into one community standard, and we want to make sure that everyone understands that these are the expectations when they're at school. Taking off a mask at school is not a personal decision. This is a communal responsibility. I'm going to pass it over to Shamari Gassner.
Hi, good evening, everyone. Each morning, every school morning, you will be receiving an Alert Media Symptoms Check survey. Please read the survey and answer it as soon as possible. Students will not be allowed on campus if the survey is not completed, or and anyone in the household, if there's a symptom of that, if you have an answer to number two to any of these symptoms, the entire household should stay home until they speak with nurse Miriam Kotek. It's really important that we fill this out. The symptoms check or survey will be sent at 6:40 in the morning. You can use an app, you can answer through your email. We send a text message to remind you to check your email. But again, can't stress how important it is for everyone to fill out the survey every morning. Temperature checks should be completed at home. That's part of the survey. For the bus, students will be checked by our bus aides that they completed the symptoms checks. And we really strongly encourage that parents wait with their students until they're on the bus, because if for some reason there is an issue or if you forgot to fill out the check, we cannot allow students on our bus, and we would not want somebody to be left at the bus stop alone. On the bus, all riders must wear masks, and they're going to be sitting in their assigned seats. Every student has their own bench, and we're going to have the windows down when weather is permitting. And if you are carpooling, we are asking if students are able to carpool within their pod, and if they're not able to, that masks are on and windows should be down, weather permitting, if they're not able to carpool within their pod. For the arrival procedures, if you look at this map over here, you can see that you will be entering off Arctic Avenue through our main entrance. You will be then turning left towards the auditorium, where you will drop off students. If you happen to have a middle school student, you can drop off by the front entrance, and your upper school students could get out there also. If you have preschool or lower school students, you will follow the directions to the preschool and lower school first, and then turn to the front of the building to drop off your upper school students there. We will be having our alert media checks there. It's really important, again, to fill out that survey, because our faculty are there just making sure that everyone is filling out the survey. If you have a student driver, they can park in the area, and they should walk their students to the area where they are designated drop-off for their division. Our restrooms will be cleaned and sanitized twice daily each. Sanitize is different than cleaning. Cleaning is a full cleaning. Sanitize is making sure that there's a quick wipe down that all the germs are killed. There are designated restrooms by divisions. The upper school ones will be clearly, every division will be clearly labeled We are asking everyone to use those designated restrooms by division, and students are not permitted to congregate in the restrooms. And if the restroom stalls are occupied, students should wait outside until the stalls are available. The dismissal procedure at 4:30, bus riders will immediately go right to the bus depot and right onto their buses. And at carpool for 4:30, we're going to be sending again a carpool dash placard for your cars and the grades. Please put them up. It'll be much quicker for our for everyone to see in the morning who the cars are. And the students will be dismissed to the carpool area. If you have middle school, they'll go in the back, but this is upper school. Upper school and middle schools, if they are together, they will come to the front of the building. And if you're upper school, again, you'll be picking up at the auditorium doors. If you have a middle school and upper school student, they'll be picking up at the front entrance. I believe the next slide has a map of what that looks like. As you can see, you'll come in, turn left on by the front entrance. If you have a middle school and upper school student, you'll pick them up there. If it's upper school only, they'll be outside by the auditorium over there. Friday dismissal, we are going to be following the 3:30 dismissal, which is the entire school. And what we're going to be doing is that upper school students will be dismissed in the same location in the front of the building by the auditorium. And if they have a middle school student in your carpool, they should go towards the middle school student at the front of the front entrance, and they will have one pickup spot there. It is going to take everyone some time to learn all these new procedures, our faculty and our drivers. So we really ask for everyone's patience as we learn all these new procedures. We can tell you that when we had welcomed our preschool on, it took a few days. And as we're welcoming our lower school and a middle and our sixth grade, in 2 days, we've already shaved off a few minutes in arrival and dismissal. So it will take time, but we're asking for everyone's patience as we go through these new procedures and protocols. And now I'll pass it off to Rabbi Kastan.
Thank you. Just wanted to quickly review. We've already sent this out in terms of openings and closures. If there are cases within our community, we will take the lead of the Department of Health on any closures. In terms of staying open, our maintained opening is based on positivity rate of below 5% and a 7-day average of cases per 100,000 of below 10. So again, below 10 cases per 100,000, below 5% positivity. In the event of a closure, we will reopen once we have a 14-day average of cases that are below 10 per 100,000 and a positivity rate below 5%. So again, to close is a seven-day average, and to reopen it is a 14-day average. And you can see the today. And the preschool and kindergarten closures will be determined by the Department of Health in case anyone on this call has students in those divisions.
So following up to tonight's meeting, we're about to open it up for questions. I ask that if you have questions, please send them to Sarah. She's going to help moderate the question answer part of tonight. But please remember to print your sign for carpool. Remember to have your students get their flu shots before November 1st and bring the documentation from whoever gave you the flu shot to Nurse Hertzfeld. If you haven't signed your COVID waivers, please do so. And finally, check the school supply list, bring your school supplies, your textbook, and a lot of positive energy and excitement on Monday. I'm gonna stop sharing my screen so I could see all of your faces, and Sarah, take it away.
Great, thank you so much. Just a couple of questions have come in and you can keep sending them. I'll try to see them all. One question just from the beginning with after davening, are you going to be having breakfast post-davening? I know that's been done in the past.
Sure. Thanks for asking that question. So our morning schedule, we have tefillah starting at 8:15. Tefillah will be over depending on the day between 8:40 and 8:55. And we have a break until 9:15. And that time is used to clean some of the spaces, transfer them over into classrooms. Students will be able to eat breakfast. We will have staff supervision in the Upper School Bay Midrash and the Media Center as like the grade level rooms. They'll also be able to go early to their classrooms and they could sit down at their desks and eat a little bit there.
Great, thank you.
Sarah, before we go on, I just want to make a quick important comment about tefillah. I know that our students are obviously eager to get to school and eager to get there on time, obviously. When we talked earlier about the procedures in terms of carpools, and Shmaria mentioned, there will certainly be a backup for the first few days until everybody figures out these new protocols. Please urge, if your teenagers are driving to school, right, we are not going to be standing there, you know, like police officers punishing them for being a few minutes late to tefillah. We understand that these are new normals. We understand these are new procedures. Please just encourage them to drive safely, to drive carefully, not cut anybody off. There will be a line to get into onto our campus until everybody gets used to the new protocols and until we can shave some time off of the morning arrivals. So everyone should just arrive calmly, remain calm as we get everyone to where they need to be in the morning.
Great, thank you. There was a question from a few parents about student activities for students that are virtual full-time, if they're able to participate or what will be for them.
Yeah. So our goal is to do our best to include students who are not in the building as best we can. That's always going to be our goal. And I'm going to ask for your patience while we work out some of the details. For advisory, they'll be able to owl in. Each advisory will be meeting in a different room, so they'll be able to join. And the teacher has the link already. The students have that link, so we'll be able to do that. For the grade level programming, we're going to try our absolute best. The larger the group, the more challenging it is. To include people on the OWL, the goal is to try to be as inclusive as possible.
Great, thank you so much. So there's been a flurry of questions that have come in regarding known cases. So I'm trying to just go through and make sure I don't miss all of the pieces of it. But the gist is, what will happen when we do have a case in our community, in the school, with the students or with the teachers? How transparent are we going to be with that information? What will be shared with the community?
This is a great question. We certainly want to make sure to share information so that everybody can remain safe. When we do our contact tracing, we will certainly notify you. To let you know if it's somebody in your kid's grade, in your kid's class, or things like that. If there are any pod closures due to any positive cases, we will post them on our website. So you can see any active closures on our website in terms of pods. We may not proactively share names unless a family, insists. But our practice is not to currently share names, but certainly you will know if there's somebody in your kid's pod, because just by rule of thumb, in terms of the contact tracing, in terms of the way that we are podding the kids by grade, if it's somebody that your child has been to school with, or either in the same pod or may have been in contact with, you will certainly know when those pods close and when there's a positive case. Certainly we will let you know in terms of positive cases also, because if there are beyond the actual county or state metrics that I shared earlier, if there is an outbreak within our community, we may decide, irrespective of what's happening with the county or state metrics, we may decide to close the school. And in that case, we will obviously communicate with everybody.
Thank you. Can you talk a bit more about what advisory time is for?
Sure. Ms. Cooper, actually, do you want to talk about this?
Absolutely. I'm happy to. So advisory is a program that's really designed with two goals in mind. One is to build a sense of community across a large grade. Some of the feedback that we've heard specifically this year, but in years past as well, is we have a diverse student population. It's a population of some amazing kids, and it's a nice way for students to have time with one another to just speak to one another, to have some FaceTime with one another, and to as well bond with a faculty member, to have a point person in our faculty who's there to discuss the goings on in their lives. Another piece of advisory that we're focusing on this year specifically is learning surrounding mental health. And I wanna be very clear about what that means specifically. The advisory program this year is not a mental health service for our students. You know, we are so lucky to have Mr. Hector as our guidance counselor and as a mental health educator on our staff, but that's not really the goal. The goal of this year in our terms of our mental health curriculum in advisory is for students to be learning about mental health, how it affects our society and their peers, and really to develop a culture of kindness surrounding destigmatizing mental health and supporting one another, whether a student is struggling with something or as just not. And we found that you know, the challenge, of course, has been with being online, having those conversations has been difficult. And we're really hopeful that with the move to advisory being an only in-person program, that it will really increase our students' ability to have those conversations in a positive way. And we are constantly open to feedback with how the program is going and are constantly revising it to meet the needs of our students. So that's gonna continue happening twice a month, just for a half an hour on Tuesdays. And I know our advisors are really excited to continue the program.
Sarah, I just want to take a question that came through me real quick. What if someone travels to or from a location with low rates, even though the state as a whole may be above the 10%? Right now, our county and state guidelines, our state guidelines, I should say, in terms of the travel policy, is that if you go to a state that is above 10%, then it, you know, it's the guidelines that I outlined earlier. So we will not be revising that, like meaning we won't be saying, well, if you go to a state that has above 10%, but the town or the city where you're going is below 10%, then it's okay, because that is the state guideline. We're not going to be taking away from the state guideline. If anything, we're actually going to be adding to the state guidelines in terms of states that might be below 10%, but from communities that people might visit frequently, who might have really high rates. We know that we're hearing some of this going on in the FRM community. So it's not that we wanna punish anybody. It's just not that we wanna keep people away from their families or friends, but it's really just about keeping our community safe. So we are meeting weekly with our medical task force. We are keeping an eye on any community transmission, and we will continue to update our travel guidelines as such.
Thank you. There was a question that came through about the activities, the student activities, and what types of activities will be taking place during that time. And I'm just gonna add on to that, any type of extracurriculars that might take place during the day, such as sports or Model UN, those types of clubs as well.
Yeah, thanks for the question. So when the students are on campus, we're going to have a grade level program. The purpose of the program is to provide a time for the students in the entire grade to be together, to do something together. It will be different types of programs as have been going on already, whether, you know, 1 week they did some baking before Rosh Hashanah, and we probably wouldn't do that specific activity in the building. But the idea is to do a program where everybody comes together, enjoys each other's company, bonds as a grade, together with our student activities leadership, Mrs. Zaghi and Rabbi Grossberg, and their grade councils as well. Each program is different, but all fun and exciting. In terms of extracurriculars, so Model UN, mock trial, debate, they're all happening. They're all happening with the caveat that we don't know exactly what all those competitions will look like, but we have faculty advisors, we have spaces for them, that they will have to be hosted virtually because they cross grades. And anytime where we have more than one grade in a specific activity, we ask that they host those virtually. But the faculty advisors, the student leaders of each of these programs are so excited to continue figuring out and working with us in terms of making it work. In terms of athletics, you know, Coach Singer sent out a survey in August. And I think now that we're getting back into a rhythm of getting back into the building, we're hoping to see if potentially there's even even more interest and what opportunities we can have there. We encourage our students to get out and move and to be involved. We've been asked by PVAC for the league to potentially put together a schedule for the second half of the year. And we don't know exactly if we'll be able to have all those sports, but we really hope that we will be able to. And so that is what's going on. If there's something that your student is interested in doing, reach out to us. We want to make sure to create as many opportunities together with your students this year.
Thank you. So just to clarify on sports, that at this point, we don't have any teams. Hopefully down the road, we'll be able to add some, but at this point, no.
Thank you for the clarification. Sorry if I wasn't.
No, it was in the chat box, so.
Yes.
I think, and I always hate when I say this, but I think I got everyone's questions that came.
I had something come in that I wanted to just address. I had a couple questions about alert media. So Shamaria, correct me if I get anything wrong, but there's an app. You could download the app. So you're going to get a text in the morning telling you to, you can fill it out by the email, or you can go directly into the app. It's called Alert Media. You can download it. It's on your phone and you could fill it out right there as well. So if that's easier for you, feel free to do it that way. And a question came in, if a family has opted into virtual, do they need to fill out the form?
They don't need it to fill out the form, but we are putting everyone in. If you would like to make any request changes for that, please email myself or Jennifer Zuckerman. We'll accommodate that.
And again, I just want to reiterate that for families that have opted to start off virtually, if and when you change your mind and you decide that you want to return to the building, if that's something that you want, we ask that you give us 24 hours notice just so that we can make sure to have everything in place. We have seats ready for your student, so we will not have to make room changes. We're ready if that is the right decision for your family. Again, I ask for as much patience as I can for next week. I know that I've been watching our colleagues, our friends, and even with my own children in the lower school and the middle school, and we're so excited to open our doors and welcome you back to campus. And all of the preparations and the practicing that we've been doing in order to try and get everything right, what we've learned is that it doesn't always go exactly as we've been planning, and we need some time to make those adjustments. We will make those adjustments. So I ask for your patience, your feedback. Please let us know if something's not working. And you have my word that we're going to try our best to correct it, to make it better, and to do our best to have an incredible, safe, and healthy return to our campus. Were there any other last minute questions?
This is not the most fun one to end on, but if there is any disciplinary measures that are going to be in place to enforce social distancing guidelines.
Yeah, so we called them communal responsibilities to try and focus on the positive that we're kol Yisrael Arivim Zeh LaZeh, right? We are all responsible for one another. And if a student is really struggling to follow those responsibilities, we will be gently reminding them. But if we see a pattern typically is around three or more times where they're really not in the right place at the right time or struggling to follow the policies that are there to ensure safety and health for everybody, then we will ask those students to move over to our virtual learning platform to use the OWL for the remainder of the week. They will be permitted to return to campus the following week that their grade level is on campus, as long as we've been able to have a conversation with the parent, with the student, and either Ms. Cooper or myself. And I'm sure that that's not going to be something that we need to talk about. We'll be able to talk about other things.
One more question. Will there be community service this year?
There is community service this year.
More positive chesed note to end on.
Yeah, there is community service this year. I got a beautiful email from a student tonight asking if some of the chesed that she's been doing already would count for chesed hours. And the answer is absolutely. If you're doing something to help other people out, we want to give you credit for that. Mrs. Zaghi oversees our chesed program. So if your students have any questions about that, any of the details, we've we have a number of opportunities. We have a whole list of opportunities, and we're also able to help you sort of think through, your student think through where might they be able to contribute to our community, whether it's our Berman community or the broader community that we are a part of. It's an important goal and it's an important value for us. So I'm glad that we get to end off. Are we ending off on that? Okay. My virtual door is always open. Our virtual doors are always open. Our actual doors are also always open because we want to try to keep the airflow moving. But I want to invite you to reach out if we haven't spoken recently, or even if we have, if there's something on your mind, I'd rather be able to talk about it than not talk about it. So we want to have conversations. We want to hear from you. We want your feedback, the good stuff that's helpful for us also. And also things that you think that we could take a deeper look at and make some changes to. We did it a little bit with advisory. We're continuing to listen to some other feedback as well. So we're thrilled to welcome you back. We're thrilled to continue teaching and learning with your students every single day in the classroom, online, in the hallways. That's where learning takes place, also outside in our tents, wherever it may be. Thank you all for joining us tonight. Have a wonderful, wonderful evening.
Good night, everybody.